page 542. Let's stand together and sing when we all get to heaven.
Good evening. Good to have you in church. Good to have visitors. And it's just a privilege to be able to come and worship in a free country, isn't it? And I'm glad to be here and glad to see each one of you. And we have a lot of prayer needs. We'll mention those later. But glad to have you. Glad to have those that are watching live stream as well. I do want to mention some announcements. But first of all, thanks to the ones that provided a couch for Miss Candy's friend and got that provided and delivered. So I appreciate that. Several men came yesterday and worked in the basement of the Old Faith and moved several things. We're trying to move out what we want and leave behind what we don't want till the very end, but they got quite a bit accomplished. I really appreciate that. And those that are just behind the scenes a lot of times doing things, thank you, thank you, thank you. It takes quite a few to get things accomplished. The parsonage is coming along well. Thank the Lord for that. And I believe the end result is going to be awesome. It was already nice, but it's going to be nicer. And all updated, new kitchen, all new bathrooms, and more of an open concept. So I'm not sure why that the Lord allowed that to happen. He knows. But anyway, we're thankful for what's being accomplished. Thankful that we had insurance, and the Lord has blessed there and provided. So any good, we're just a distraction maybe, but yeah, God has something in it. Now, are you like me? You want to know why? I don't know why, but I think one day I'll look back and, oh, that makes sense now. But right now in the middle of it, we just trust him. And I've contemplated, I've spent a little bit of time probably that I shouldn't have trying to figure it out, you know, it's just better just to not let God take care of it. Amen. We'll mention what we have going on, some announcements. I was going to say some outreaches, but we have outreach tomorrow evening, 6 o'clock. But I would encourage not just Thursdays, every day, but especially on a Thursday, make an attempt to hand somebody a gospel tract or to tell someone about Christ. Sunshine Seniors on Friday evening, and it's going to be good. Now, Ed de-emphasized it and made it sound like we was having tacos. And that sounds like Taco Bell. Nothing against Taco Bell, but it'll be better than that. Now, there might be some of you thinking, well, if you're not going to have chicken or hamburgers or, well, you can bring that too. We're going to have some fried chicken, you know. I know people that go to the Mexican restaurant and order traditional food. I'm not sure why, but they do that, you know. I better move on. It'll be a great time Friday evening, and you know you're old enough. Some of y'all is just acting like you're not. You're old. You might as well just step on in that arena and have a good time. It'll be a blessing. Pray for our teens. They'll leave on Friday for the teen prom alternative. They'll be going to Cincinnati on Friday, come back on Saturday evening. Pray for safety. Pray they'll have a great time. You say, what's an alternative? Well, it's an alternative to what the world offers. They'll have a dance and all that stuff going on here. That's not my place to get too involved in that. But I want to offer something for those that don't want to participate in that, and that's what we do. And I'm excited about those that are going on that. That'll be a great time. At 9 o'clock Saturday morning, men's prayer breakfast, all right? And that'll be a great time. And you, Brother Clarence is cooking. And I know that's going to be good. I would encourage you to come. We'll have some fellowship around food and then have a brief challenge, then also have a time of prayer. So I encourage you to be a part of that. On Sunday in the a.m., we'll have Dr. Dewey Whitfield. He and his wife will be here, missionaries to the Hispanic, and I know you'll enjoy that. Sunday afternoon, 5 o'clock, kids' choir. Make you aware of that. Then our teen service and afterglow on Sunday evening. And don't forget in our bulletin things that are coming up. On April 28th, we'll have our baby dedication service. Also on May the 10th, don't forget the mother and daughter. See, now the mother-daughter celebration. I about forgot Saturday. The ladies are going to Maranatha for their ladies' conference. I don't want to forget that. And then also on May the 19th, our Bibles for Grad service. There's a book in the foyer for those that that like to pick out who they put their name in whose Bible. That's, you can do that back there. But if you just want to give towards that without doing that, just indicate that on an envelope, and that'll get sent into the appropriate place. The Christmas joy bags, that was in the bulletin on Sunday. There's more of those copies around. I want to remind you of that as well. You know what? There's a lot of opportunities to serve the Lord.
Yes, there is.
There is. Just listen to what's going on and get involved where you can, and let's win souls for Christ. Amen?
Amen.
He's coming back, maybe soon. And let's make sure you don't leave anybody behind. Don't maybe neglect to tell that person that you really care about Christ. I encourage you to do that. All right, Brother Jeff.
Take your hymnals once again. Turn to page 521. Let's stand together and sing Redeemed. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb.
few moments and shake hands, fellowship. Don't mind me. Just keep on shaking hands and fellowshipping. Isn't that good? Hey, you wait. I wait all day to come to church. I'm not rushing you.
Amen.
That's right. Amen. We had our stewards. Of course, they met in a different way, but our deacons meeting last night, and I'm thankful for those men and for Pastor Matt. And the Lord's been good. He really has. And I'm thankful for the business and that we are able to discuss the ministry outreaches and what we pray for and Bible study. Brother Gale brought a great Bible study last night. Each month our different deacon brings a Bible study, and it's a great time. I really appreciate that. But let's go to prayer and ask the Lord to bless this offering. Lord, we love you. Thank you so much for all that you do for us. And Lord, as I look in this place, I thank you for each individual, and those maybe for the first time, those that have been here all their life. Lord, we've come to worship you, and I pray you be pleased. Bless the offering. Everything we do, I pray that it would be something that you would get the glory from. Help me as I speak here a little bit. You direct that, and may it be pleasing. We love you. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Sometimes he calms me. Sometimes the storm still rages on, but I feel the sweetest peace. It's such a joy to know that my Lord knows just what I need. Sometimes he calms the storm, and sometimes he calms me. Circumstances may overtake and bring me to my knees, but when I feel I cannot cope with this life's troubled seas, I call on Him whose voice can still much greater storms than these. His words bring peace into my soul when He says, child, I'm in control. And with one touch, He calms the storm in me. Sometimes He calms the storm, and sometimes He calms me. Sometimes the storm still rages on, but I feel the sweetest peace. It's such a joy to know that my Lord knows just what I need. Sometimes He calms the storm, and sometimes He calms me. It's such a joy to know that my Lord knows just what I need. Sometimes He calms the storm, and sometimes He calms me.
Yes, amen. Right. Amen. Amen. He was a fallen angel, sounds like. Wonderful. Brother Bobby.
Right. Amen. We'll get back with you on that one. Amen. Thank you, Brother Bubby. I appreciate Brother Bubby's heart. And he loves gospel music, but he don't just love gospel music. He loves church because he goes every time a door is open somewhere. Amen.
I'm here to tell you, pain went from an 8 to a 0 after I had that procedure done. And I'm thankful.
Amen.
I'm very thankful.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. I was thinking of the words of that song, He Knows What We Need.
Yes.
There's been a lot of times I thought I knew what I needed. I've done some things. I've bought some things that I did not need. Anybody else bought anything they didn't need? Yeah, that's why we have yard sales. Amen. But I'm glad he knows what I need. He knew what Miss Nancy needed, amen. He knew what Miss Carrie needed. He knows what Bubby needs. He knows what you need and what I need. Isn't that wonderful? I'm glad we serve a God that is that connected to us, that cares that much for us, that even what might seem simple as a phone call, God's there. Isn't that good? A procedure, God's there. Large or small, isn't that wonderful? Yes. Amen. We'll pray for Miss Christina that she'll be able to find someone. If you didn't know, the storm they had blew the whole back of her roofing off of her house, and it was a metal roof, and it just mangled it. I mean, it was incredible. But thankfully, they got somebody there pretty speedily, got it tarped and temporarily covered, and that's God's watch care, and we're thankful for that. Isn't that good? I don't know about you, but I like to hear what God does. It's exciting. So let's turn to 1 Peter chapter 2. We'll take off where we left off last week and get into this very exciting subject that everybody loves, which is the question of submission. Now, one thing I've noticed over the years, it seems like the word submission, that we automatically go to spousal. Husband and wife, you know, wives and husbands. But, you know, there's other areas of submission that I believe God counts as important. Think about Him, okay? You think about our Lord Jesus and what He did. He was submissive to the Father. He did exactly what His Father told Him to do. And I'm glad He did. Praise the Lord. But in our hearts, in our lives, He has something for us as well. Let's go to 1 Peter chapter 2, and we'll begin reading in... I'm going to back up just a little bit. Let's go back to verse 13, but we'll begin our study in verse 15. Submit yourselves to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake, whether it be to the king as supreme or unto governors... as unto them that are sent by Him for the punishment of evildoers and for the praise of them that do well. For so is the will of God that with well-doing you may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men. As free and not using your liberty for a cloak of maliciousness, but as the servants of God. Honor all men. Love the brotherhood. Fear God. Honor the king. Servants, be subject to your masters with all fear, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the froward. For this is thankworthy. If a man for conscience towards God endure grief, suffering wrongfully, for what glory is it? If when ye be buffeted for your faults, ye shall take it patiently. But if when you do well and suffer for it, you take it patiently, this is acceptable with God. This is, in my mind, a hard writing to receive. In 2024, this is a hard lesson to learn. And we see it in the business place. We see it politically around our nation. There's a lot of things in this that are contrary to how we function in society today. And we'll look at this question of submissiveness just a little bit more this evening as the Lord allows. But let's have a word of prayer. We'll get started, okay? Lord, I need your help, and I pray that I'll do what you want done. And thank you for the music, Lord, the special, and how it ministered to our hearts and spoke to us. Thank you for testimonies, Lord. I'm glad that you know what we need and that you help us and provide. You shut doors and open doors, and we're glad for that. And bless your word. I pray that it would help somebody and do the work you want it to do, which would please you. And ultimately, Lord, I want to please you. I don't want to get sidetracked or off on some thought. Help me to stay focused on your word. And Lord, we'll thank you and praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. So we looked at kind of the exhortation, the extent of this submission, and now there's an explanation here that begins in verse 15. He's going to explain God's demand that we submit to those in authority over us. And I'm telling you, you all may be just 100% locked into that and have no problem with it, but the majority of people struggle with submitting to authority. How many of you have children? Have they ever had a problem submitting to the authority? Yes, they'll challenge that at times, some in a large way, some in a small way. It's just we have a sinful nature. And he explains it in the terms of our Lord. We'll look at that. Our liberty and our location. We'll look at those things first. Everything comes back to the Lord. Look in verse 15. It says, "For so is the will of God, that with well-doing ye may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men." Now the expression there, to put to silence, means to muzzle. The word ignorance here means it's a self-caused ignorance. And then the word foolish is a strong word that means senseless ones. So get what we're saying here. For the will of God, that with well-doing you may put to silence or muzzle the ignorance, that is the self-caused ignorance. Most all my problems are self-inflicted, let me just tell you. I can point fingers and it's somebody's fault, but you know, it's the guy that looks in the mirror's fault almost all the time. Self-caused ignorance. Then it says the ignorance of foolish men. Foolish means the senseless ones. Now, the Lord used this same word describing the hypocrisy of the Pharisees in Luke 11:40. He says, "Ye fools, did not he that made that which is without make that which was within also?" See, Satan has a fertile mind. Satan's at work every day. He hasn't let up. He's after people. He's, you know, down through the ages, he has invented and circulated all kinds of things to be destructive to the Lord's people, their beliefs, and their behavior. There are lies today. I mean, Christianity in some ways is made fun of. that we have this crutch of the Bible, this crutch of faith. You know, people think you just ought to believe whatever you want, and Scientology and all the things that are out there. And they'll come against and almost mocking what a Christian believes from the Word of God. You think about the church today, there are a lot of churches that have strange doctrines and practices. Now, that's not so much what he's talking about, but there is that. Think about it. There are churches, and I'll be cautious. I'll call it out. They slay one another. Somehow they have some spirit or control where they can knock people down and slay them in the spirit. There are those that they pray to painted images of the Virgin Mary. That's not what the Bible teaches. Now, that might be what a particular denomination practices, but I'm saying there are some of those things out there. There are those that worship animals or old relics of things that they look to, and that's what they look to as their worship, as to their God. That's not what the Bible teaches. But that's really not what he's talking about here. He's talking about, what these are to me are sad accounts of how gullible people are. You don't have to watch TV very long to find somebody that wants your money. And you send them their money, they're going to send you something that's going to bless your heart. A special piece of cloth. You need to be careful about some of that stuff. The Bible's pretty clear. Those things are out there. But what Peter's talking about here is just an outright attack on the people of God rather than the deviations they might have within. Those that are against the church. We got a little taste of it, just a little taste of it during the pandemic. There were those that tried their best to take that opportunity to squelch the outreach and the worship of the church. It happened. You can't deny it happened. It's documented all over the media. It's documented that there were churches that were forced unnecessarily in a way they couldn't worship, they couldn't meet. We experienced some of that as well. We followed the guidelines until it became something we could not follow because it didn't pan out and it wasn't all truth. But I think what he's talking about here, the pagans accused the Christians of doing things that just weren't so, finding a way to discredit what was going on. And what he's saying, or what Peter's saying, the obvious answer to these types of slanders is for Christians to live an impeccable life, a consistent, faithful life, and their beliefs be shown to all. See, conformity is a problem. You got to be careful about conformity to this world. Yes, they're going to. We've not experienced times like I believe are coming if the Lord tarries. And how strong will our faith be in times of real trouble? And the best way to combat any of that is just stay faithful to the book. Amen. Faithful to God's word. And that's what we need to do. Slanders will die when they're exposed fairly and honestly to truth. Let God be true and every man a liar. Yes, the Bible is where we go for truth. I've said it before, as far as verbally, it's kind of like if you always tell the truth, you never have to remember what you said. Yeah. That's really helpful when you get older. You can't remember anyway. So make sure you tell the truth, or you're going to be keep making up stories. Well, the same thing's true with our lives. Live a life of truth. And it'd be impeccable. You know, what amazes me is let somebody run for office. Man, you'll start finding out things you didn't know. Some of it true, probably a lot of it not. To the place we don't know what to believe. Would you agree? You don't know what to believe. What you hear on the media, I mean, you don't know if it's somebody trying to distort things so this person can't progress. I mean, I don't know. But the best thing we could do as Christians is to live an impeccable life before the Lord.
Amen.
That is unquestionable, no doubt about it. And that's what he's saying. Now, look in verse 16. As free and not using your liberty for a cloak of maliciousness, but as the servants of God, one way that we can express our liberty in Christ is by our loyalty to a constituted authority. In America, we have a constituted authority. That's a president. We have a Supreme Court. It trickles right on down to the state level. We have laws that we are to obey, like it or not. We do. No, we don't like that. Let me back up a little bit. I may say more about it later. There's things I don't like that's going on today in our country, but I need to be careful to not use my tongue to talk about, but to use my tongue to pray about. Because regardless of what you think about whoever it is in whatever office, whether you like it or not, they are in an authority.
Right.
And God says that we submit to that authority. Now, that we'll look at an exception here in a minute. But we don't like to hear that. And probably we would all do well to spend less time criticizing and talking about those people and more time praying, and we would see things change.
Amen.
But it's more fun to talk about it, isn't it? Don't answer. It's easier to talk about and be opinionated about. And sometimes we're talking about and being opinionated about things we don't even know what we're talking about. Because we're basing it on what we hear that may not even be factual. But you can go to this book and get the facts. And we are to be submissive to those, like it or not. He uses the word cloak, which means of means of hiding. Peter uses this in a sense of covering wickedness, you might say. What you have to realize is we belong to God. Now, this might not set right for some people, maybe even those watching live stream. We belong to God, not the American government. I love America. I'm thankful to be an American. I don't say that critical, but my loyalty and my allegiance is to my God.
Hallelujah.
It needs to be. Matter of fact, that's how the nation was started. We've sure moved away from that.
Amen.
We're slaves of God, if you want to call it that, not of man. We don't submit to human institutions as slaves, but as God's free people. As God's free people. Think about that. We cannot equate Christianity with any political party. Be careful. Hey, I've got my opinions. I've got my thoughts. But be careful that you don't equate it that way. We start equating good and evil and right and wrong with the wrong scales. Be careful about that. Our alignment is with God, and we need to be free to share the gospel with everybody. I don't get real political. There's a reason for that. I'm not a politician. I'm a preacher. And my desire is, no matter what your stripe is to help you, to love you, to lead you.
Amen.
And I'll tell you the same thing I always say, when my best voting advice I can give you is vote the book.
Yep.
I can't go wrong saying that. But you can go wrong not doing it. You can go wrong not following what this Bible says, okay? So there's an authority. And we'll look at that a little further here in just a minute. I'm getting sidetracked. I want to be careful. Don't do that. Lord, help me. God, anytime civil government requires God's people to go against His commands, we must follow God. You understand that? I'll explain it a little closer. As pastor and with the leadership we had, we made some decisions during the pandemic that I felt were right. I'll stand by those. We didn't meet for a while, but there was a point in time we said, we're going back. We were able to live stream. We were to reach out as best we could. But I look back on, I don't like any of that. I didn't like the feeling of someone saying we couldn't worship. It's a bad feeling, wasn't it? Because the Bible says to forsake not the assembling of yourselves together. We did it for human health purposes, and I think it got out of hand. I'm probably making people happy and mad here all at the same time. But the idea I'm trying to make is following what God says. The church must always remain the conscience of the state. Think about that. I'm glad there's people, I know of churches in other areas, in other states, that stood up and said, we're going to meet, even though they were cramming fines down their throat, because it was more important to follow God. That's tough stuff, I know. It's not real popular. We'll be civil, but not silent. We have great liberty in Christ. That bothers some people. We do have great liberty in Christ. I think Peter could probably remember what the Bible says in John 8:36. If the Son therefore shall make thee free, ye shall be free indeed. Now that doesn't mean we're free to do whatever we want. That's not a license to sin. I've heard all those phrases, you have too. It means He set us free to be devoted and willing to serve Him. He said, if you're saved, He sets you free. And you are allowed and enabled to serve Him. But we have a civil government that we follow. We obey the laws of the land, whether we like them or not. Amen. Verse 17, honor all men, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the king. Let's look at that here for just a minute. I think we need to rethink about those that are around us, and the Bible talks about that. It makes no difference where we are, we're to do that. Peter is writing, he was in Babylon. It's not where we are that matters, it's whose we are. Whose we are. If you're a child of the king, there's some stipulations there. We're to give honor to all men, regardless of color, regardless of class, regardless of creed. God makes no difference. Oh, we do, but God doesn't. Politically, we're so messed up today with this. Best I can tell is there's one race. It's human race. That would sure help us a whole lot if we just dwell there for a while. The human race. All types of people, different countries, different dialects. I mean, we have a human race. That would solve a lot of stuff right there. God makes no difference. He sends that beneficial rain on everybody. You don't pick and choose people. God loves all of us. I love the song. You can look in your hymnal if you want. It's 299. You know it. Rescue the perishing. I want you to listen to the words. rescue the perishing, care for the dying, snatch them in pity from sin and the grave, weep over the erring one, lift up the fallen, tell them of Jesus, the mighty to save. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying. Jesus is merciful. Jesus will save. Let me go on. Though they are slighting him, still he is waiting. We're critical. We get a little wound up sometimes. Jesus is still waiting. He still loves them. Waiting the penitent child to receive. Plead with them earnestly. Plead with them gently. He will forgive if they only believe. Down in the human heart, crushed by the tempter. Oh, Satan, wicked thing. Feelings lie buried that grace can restore. Touched by a loving heart, wakened by kindness, cords that were broken will vibrate once more. Listen to those words. Touched by a loving heart. We should live impeccable lives. We should be the most honorable, the most honest, the most kind, the most loving people that there are. Rescue the perishing. Duty demands it. Strength for thy labor. The Lord will provide. Back to the narrow way, patiently win them. Tell the poor wanderer, a Savior has died and rescued the perishing. It's a wonderful song if you listen to the words. How we behave ourselves and how we obey the laws of the land and how we submit to the authorities that are over us matter. This world needs to see that. There are stories all through church history of people that have been redeemed and remade by God's amazing grace. We often look at the worst case scenario, that one that's had all the troubles in the world that God saved and placed them over here. You know what? That's me. I was lost. There's not different levels of people going to hell. If you're lost, you're lost. I was lost. And God saved me. Thank the Lord for that. The gospel is the power of God unto salvation. Giving some poor person back his sense of honor might be the first step in his salvation. Think about the Lord and how he dealt with the despised and rejected Zacchaeus. Look how he helped him. I don't have time to go to Luke chapter 19. We could look at that. Peter would remember that. The Lord dealt with the traitor Judas, trying to rescue him from his doom. It says, love the brotherhood, the brotherly relationship that we enjoy with other believers in the bonds of Christ. Now, you think about it. One of the reasons that most of us are here is because of the Lord Jesus Christ. And because of that, we have this in common. We shake hands. We know a little bit about each other because we've experienced some good and bad times together. We've shared each other's burdens, and we recognize that. We love those that love the Lord. The word for love here is the agape love, the highest kind of love that talks about in God's Word. It means literally to regard with favor or to make much of someone. I mean, love is, a lot of people, the character word for Christianity, you might say. Think of the love that God had when He sent His Son to die for you and I. That's the kind of love we should have. The Bible teaches that. It seeks the welfare of all. It's not based on human feelings. Not based on feelings. Doesn't fluctuate. First Corinthians chapter 13. Turn there with me for just a moment. Many of you know this, but not, I'm sure not everybody does. So I think it'd be good. I just feel led to go here. 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Beautiful passage of Scripture. Though I speak with the tongues of men and angels and have not charity, I am become as sounding brass and a tinkling cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains and have not charity, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned and have not charity, it profiteth me nothing. Charity suffereth long and is kind. Charity envieth not. Charity vaunteth not itself, is not puffed up, doth not behave itself unseemly, seeketh not her own, is not easily provoked, thinketh no evil. Wow, that's a lot. That's love. Beareth all things, believeth all things, hopeth all things, endureth all things. Charity never faileth. But whether there be prophecies, they shall fail. Whether there be tongues, they shall cease. Whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part shall be done away. When I was a child, I spake as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then shall I know even as I am known. And now abideth faith, hope, charity, these three. But the greatest of these is charity. I just described really the kind of people we ought to be in obedience to the authority that's over us, which is Christ, our local government, a pastor, a boss. We're going to go in a little farther here. I think this will explain it a little better. First of all, in verse 17, it talks about submissive regarding those, and it's talking about God. We are to fear God. That's not some kind of afraid fear that he's talking about. It's a kind of fear that's capable to cause us to have a relationship with him. The Bible says in Proverbs 9:10, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. And the knowledge of the holy is understanding. When we have a healthy fear of God, it has a sanctifying effect on our behavior. When you think about who God is and you reverence who He is, then all of a sudden it'll change how you live your life. It really will. Think back in Peter's day, the fear of Nero hung like a dark cloud over them in that day. If we're not careful, the fear of political leaders or the fear of somebody will be haunted by a dark cloud every day. You know what I'm talking about. There's some people so eat up with what's going on in this world, they can't even enjoy their Christian life. That's not how He wants us to live our lives. The right kind of fear of God has an effect on our behavior. The fear of God will drive out the fear of man. When you believe God and understand God and how much He loves you, it'll drive out the... We joke about it, but it's really true. I mean, the worst thing that could happen to me is the best thing.
Yes.
If someone will take my life, I'm going to be with Jesus.
Yes, Lord. Thank you.
Think about that. It sounds silly, but it's true.
Right.
We fear the worst things that could happen in this life when it's going to be the thing that brings us face to face with Jesus.
Yes,
it's silly when you think about it like that. Peter could remember the words of the Lord when he said, "Fear not them which kill the body, but are not able to kill the soul." In other words, if I die tonight, my soul lives on forever and ever with Jesus Christ. And it goes on to say, but rather fear Him which is able to destroy both soul and body in hell. That's in Matthew 10:28. So fear God. Then it says we're to honor the king. The king there then was Nero. Kind of a monster of a man. Turn to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. I want to read some of this passage here. Talks about the mystery of iniquity and why God allows tyrants such as Nero to climb to positions of power in ways where they can have their own will and way in an ungodly manner. It says now in verse 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 1, "Now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, and by our gathering together unto Him, that you be not soon shaken in mind, or be troubled, neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter, as from us, as that the day of Christ is at hand. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come, except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition, who opposeth and exalteth himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he as God sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Remember ye not that when I was yet with you, I told you these things? And now you know what withholding that might be revealed in his time. For the mystery of iniquity doth already work. Only he who now letteth will let until he be taken out of the way." I don't know that I want to go and read all of this. He says in verse 16, "Now our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God, even our Father which has loved us and has given us everlasting consolation and good hope through grace, comfort your hearts and establish you in every good work, word and work." I'm sorry. As I look at this passage of Scripture here, we think about, you know, why are we to honor those that have the rule over us? Why are we to bow down to them? You know, a lot of times we don't know the full story. You know, you can pick somebody out in your mind and you don't know why they're like they are. You don't know their background. You don't know their history. You don't know all about them, but God does. God's grace is that God loved poor, lost Nero as much as he loved noble-minded Nehemiah. God loves everyone the same. See, we don't know how to do that because that's not how we operate. We have people we don't love. You wouldn't say it out loud, but you don't love them. And it's, you say, how do you know? It's evident in how we think and how we talk about them. But God loves everybody. He loves everybody. Honor the king. That's what Daniel did. Despite the king's attempt to murder three of his close personal friends, that's what Daniel did. He always addressed Nebuchadnezzar in terms that befitted his rank. Let me look at Daniel 5, 17 and 18. "Then Daniel answered and said before the king, let thy gifts be to thyself, and give thy rewards to another. Yet I will read the writings unto the king, and make known unto him the interpretation. O thou king, the most high God gave Nebuchadnezzar thy father a kingdom, and majesty, and glory, and honor." Look how he spoke to him. He spoke with respect. Remember, he came to interpret the dream, wanted him to find out what was going on. It's the same with King Darius in Daniel chapter 6 and verse 19. He says this, "Then the king arose very early in the morning and went in haste into the den of the lions. And when he came to the den, he cried with a lamentable voice unto Daniel. And the king spoke and said to Daniel, O Daniel, servant of the living God, is thy God whom thou servest continually able to deliver thee from the lions?" Do you see what happened here based on how Daniel lived his life before the king in that day? The king noticed that something different about that guy, and he saw God working in his life, and that's how we're supposed to do.
That's right.
Yeah. That's how, Daniel just trusted God. This is what Daniel said unto the king. Now, this is the king that put him in the lion's den. the king that intended harm to come upon him. You know, that one that's doing you wrong, that one that meant to do harm to you, that boss that didn't treat you like you felt you should have been treated, that spouse or that family member or that whatever it is. This is what he says to that person. Then said Daniel unto the king, O king, live forever. My God has sent his angel and has shut the lion's mouths, that they have not hurt me, for as much as before him innocency was found in me, and also before thee, O king, have I done no hurt. Then was the king exceedingly glad for him. The king was glad that he didn't get devoured by the lions. Well, that's his little switch there, isn't it? I believe Daniel's life and testimony made a big difference. Then was the king exceeding glad for him and commanded that they should take Daniel up out of the den. So Daniel was taken up out of the den, and no manner of hurt was found upon him because he believed in his God. And the king commanded, and they brought those men that accused Daniel, and they cast them in the den of lions. What a turnabout. Yeah. All that happened because somebody said, you know what? I'm going to do what's right. I'm going to live right. I'm going to live above regardless of what they say and do. Regardless of how they treat me, I'm just going to do what's right. And that's what he did. Daniel's honoring of these kings led to remarkable changes in their behavior. When I read the news and I hear about rioting and all this kind of stuff going on, that doesn't excite me. That bothers me. It makes me think little of the group. Because we have a God that's able to fight our battles for us. We really do. We see this principle of honoring those in authority also exemplified by the Apostle Paul. I'm going to read this. I'll close up with this right here. Anxious to get to the bottom of this disturbance, the commander arranged a meeting between the prisoner and his Jewish authorities. He says in Acts chapter 23:1, and Paul, earnestly beholding the council, said, Men and brethren, I have lived in all good conscience before God until this day. And the high priest Ananias commanded them that stood by him to smite him on the mouth. Then Paul said unto him, God shall smite thee, thou whited wall, for thou forsittest thou to judge me after the law, and commanded me to smitten contrary to the law? And they that stood by said, Revilest thou God's high priest? Then said Paul, I wish not, brethren, that he was the high priest. For it is written, Thou shalt not speak evil of the ruler of thy people. Paul jumped out to conclusions here and was kind of corrected there in the act and made apology. Paul was right, and God did smite him later on. He was murdered later. Just trust God. I don't like what's going on. I've already said I'm thankful to be an American. But there are certain things we need to submit to. And we need to pray for our leaders. Pray for protection. Pray that God would lead them and guide them. Live lives. You know what would attract more is we'd have a revival. We could change the city. And if every church did that in their city, we could change the state. If every church did that in their state, we'd change the nation. Verse 18, we'll get into this next week. Servants, be subject to your masters with all fear. Not only to the good and gentle, but also to the froward. Wow. Peter turns from talking about being submissive to those in the state to submission to those that rule in the everyday life. Bosses. That'll be interesting. Not only to the good and gentle, but also to the froward. Be subject. Well, that's a good way to end it right there. Hey, You know what? I love coming to church. Brother David, I don't know what to do. How do you rescue that? You don't need to speak. I didn't know who it was till you said something. If you know what, you're watching on live stream. We're not as crazy as it might seem. You just can't hear everything that goes on. Let's have a word of prayer, okay? Lord, we love you, and I thank you for this place and these verses that talk about us being subject and submissive to the authorities that we have. May we be outstanding citizens. May we trust you and live for you and live exemplary lives before this world, that they might see there's something different, something they desire, something they want. Lord, you've been good to us, and we thank you for that. And I pray you'll help us to do your will and to follow you as closely as we can. Lord, bless the prayer time. There's many with needs. We thank you for the praises. You've been good. We could spend all night talking about how good you've been. But, Lord, we have needs, those that have needs here, and I pray you'll help us in that time as well. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, Pastor Kelly, you can.